Yeah, so this is going to be a quick 5-minute presentation where, you know, where what we are talking about is, you know, a consolidated set of learnings that we've gotten, that we've, you know, consolidated as key considerations and best practices in Indian industrial rooftop solar projects. Where do we point? Right. So a little bit about the kind of experience that we've had. So we are a SP1A rated company by MNRE, which is the highest financial and technical capability rating awarded by MNRE. We work with primarily industrial customers, and over the last 3 years, we've kind of really filled up this logo side of things. So apart from the 7 megawatt of rooftop solar plants that we've done, we are obviously working on, you know, a bigger pipeline of rooftop solar plants, and also gotten into utility scale power plants in the last 1 year, where we've done you know, major work in the taluk-wise scheme in Karnataka. The open access ground mounted project, which is listed over here, is I think one of the most exciting things that we are doing so far. This is a 5.5 megawatt captive power plant for Merino, who's also one of the very few industrial houses I think in India who are actually going for a full 100% renewable energy in all their plants across the country, and they've chosen Sunsure as the partner of choice, and they're doing all of it in capex. So this 5.5 megawatt plant is actually a captive open access plant to be put in Haryana. The due commissioning date is March, and this is a plant with trackers,
right?
By the way, yes. So I think a lot of firsts in this plant. This is probably the first plant of this scale by a captive industry which is using trackers. So with those set of filters, that becomes a very unique thing. So yeah, moving forward, as a company, we have a goal of reaching 2 gigawatts by 2022, which is going to be a 5% market share in the rooftop solar if we actually hit the target, which we've kind of categorically decided yesterday that we'll not hit. We are a bunch of, you know, IIT Delhi graduates who are actually running the entire company. We are in the business of large scale distributed solar power plants as well as O&M and consulting. So now coming to the actual technology part, to address the actual question that Amit shot at me, is that for solar PV, we really believe that it has become an industrial asset now. It has become, you know, anything that it has become as important as any other asset that an industrial actually accounts for in their capex when they're setting it up. The costs have come down 4 to 6 rupees per unit, which is better almost everywhere in compared to any other DISCOM. The equity payback in CAPEX is close to 3-4 years. If you're doing OPEX, then there's no question of equity payback and you still get the same kind of prices. The self-reliance is you know, the main reason why industries are going for solar. If you look at the last, we actually did look at the last 10 years of trends of increasing power prices across 8 major states in India. And we saw there is an average 7% escalation on the grid side, which is very high if you're looking at a, you know, if you're comparing against the 25-year horizon which a solar power plant presents. The technology is highly proven. Solar is actually one of the oldest technologies out there today, which are, you know, at the scale of proliferation at which they are. 1950 was the first year of use, and it was actually used for a NASA application, which means that they've actually done a lot of research back in 1950 itself. 25 years is the warranted life of that technology, of solar. And I've talked to multiple industrial players, and there is no other equipment or anything that they put capex on which has this kind of a warranty life. Maximum warranty life is maybe 10 years. So this again speaks for the kind of maturity that the technology has already seen. The transition is easy. So this is where I feel that, you know, most of the technology advancement is happening, right? Because on the equipment side, storage, from, you know, from our knowledge of talking with companies like Panasonic and, you know, leaders in lithium ion, we know that technology is still at least 2 to 3 years down the line before it actually becomes even considerable for an industrial application. Lead acid batteries, all of us have struggled with it. It's not the solution that you would like to use for a large scale industrial application, is what we believe. So the technology really is gonna come in, we think, asset management, where, you know, we as a company are doing a lot of things. I think all the good solar EPC companies are doing this, and even developers. So not much to talk about here. So we've put together, you know, over here we've kind of divided success in selling rooftop solar in two parts, right? One is, you know, actually achieving commercial confidence of customers, and the other one is actually achieving operational confidence. So the commercial confidence, I think, mostly comes from a sound financial modeling. This is one place where I feel that there is a lot of scope for standardization or some player to actually come out from the banking side, or, you know, like IREDA or an SBI or doing all these rooftop financing, to actually come out with sound financial modeling methods, right? Because if we go to customers today and we find that one customer has seen a different model, the other customer has seen a different model, or the same customer has seen three different models, right? Then apart from the financial modeling, it's actually what sells to customers, we feel, is actual case studies of projects that you've actually done, and referenceability. So you should actually be able to take your customer from that you're trying to sell to a plant that you've actually put up and show the, you know, the confidence that you have over there. The operational confidence. Now there is synchronization with DCs is a technology which is, you know, now becoming more and more desirable for industries. So a lot of industrial plants that had been put so far actually shut down the plants when DGs are in use. And a lot of SCADA companies have actually now come out with smart ways of, you know, conditioning inverter power. And of course, inverters like SunGrow, Huawei, and all these guys which are coming in are making this easier and easier. 2 years back, you could only bring an inverter down by like 25% in one step. Now you can come at a 0.5% with Huawei and SunGrow. Plant performance monitoring. So this is something where, you know, some amount of automation is required. There are a lot of SCADA players, but most of them are designed from a ground-mounted perspective. The visualizations are not intuitive. The end customer is not able to consume those solutions, even though they spend maybe 3 lakhs, 4 lakhs on them for every plant. So what we do is we've kind of automated the weekly reporting process. And every week we just send I'll show a glimpse of what we send every week to our clients. Then maintenance of equipment. I think this is a bad practice that has actually come from the ground mounted and into the rooftop system, where, you know, everybody knows that every 6 months at the max you should actually go out and test all your strings and everything. And so it's there on paper, but nobody actually does it. And even if they do, they don't digitize those records. So I think what we are trying to do really hard with all our plants is trying to digitize all these testing records, right? Open circuit current of strings and how insulation is, let's say, degrading over time, and how those actually connect to performance, right? And then project management, right? Project management, because it's when you're doing it in a commercial environment, you need to be very, very sure about the kind of timelines that you promise your customers. You know, a little bit of up and down on that leads to a lot of dissatisfaction on the customer's front. So these are, by the way, all of these are actually technology interventions that we'll actually talk about. So this, for example, is a case study, right? We for one of our clients that we actually take out their electricity bill on a monthly basis and actually show them how much they've saved as compared to last year. DC synchronization. So this is one of the plants where we are actually doing DC synchronization. So the blue line that you see is actually solar power, and you see that even though irradiation is really high, but because there is a lot of power being drawn from DG, the solar power is kind of getting conditioned as load is varying. So this is under a highly varying load condition where the solar plant is actually able to perform or respond so well, right? And this is something that we did around a year back. So the technology is actually improved over time. This is a view of the kind of reporting we do. So on the left, you see an email which goes with, you know, a snapshot of the performance ratio, actual energy generated, irradiance, and so on over the week, and a set of insights on top of that. And then we've created some very simple, this technology is extremely simple these days, right? So we've actually created, you know, with using a drag drop technology platform, a way to actually send daily emails and alerts based on certain conditions. Then there is a lot of data-driven maintenance that we do. So for example, here is a slightly complex example where we actually compared the performance of, this is a peak performance issue that you're seeing. So these two distributions that you see, one of them is a healthy plant, the other plant is not that healthy. But at the peak time, they were actually producing the same kind of energy. So if you look at the graph bang in the middle, you'd see that the area under the two graphs, the dark one and the light one, is pretty similar, right? Which means the kind of energy that is produced between this period from both plants is the same, but the actual behavior of producing that energy is highly different. So this plant is actually going under, the plant with two peaks is actually going under heavy derating. So it kind of goes up all the way to the maximum production it can and then drops down. And then between that fluctuation itself, it's producing all the energy it can. Whereas the other plant, you see, is actually operating in a very specific time power range, right? So here we knew that, you know, what something like a normal SCADA will never tell you, the total, by giving total energy, you'll never see whether this one is healthier than the other. But it's this kind of forensic investigation that you actually kind of need to get into the plant and do on a regular basis. Again, there are no commercially available solutions for this. So I think this is again a place where that can happen. And then this is project management. So we use Zoho projects, which is again, you know, off the shelf, maybe 60-70,000 rupees a year sort of subscription for unlimited projects and unlimited users, which has kind of brought down the on phone time for our management team. Okay, coming from a consulting background, the first thing I was able to see in solar was that everybody is on the phone all the time, and that's basically just follow-ups. So with Zoho, we've kind of been able to reduce that for our rooftop projects. And yes, so that's I think.
Coming back to you, Ritesh, the concept of using trackers to get more flat curve is really a fantastic idea, which is picking up. But now comparing that with the additional cost, how does the entire equation pan out when the developers are looking at with the capex versus the returns in terms of additional generation?
Actually, I've just done an analysis for Badla. At Badla, we did an LCOE analysis. Did it for one of my clients who's looking at going for the entire 750 megawatt. And with trackers, we are able to get down to 2.34 at Badla. So from the 2.44, we're able to hit the 2.34 mark. And this is without AD. And with AD, we're able to hit the 2.09 mark. So that will tell you that we are able to get with trackers that at that rate. So from that perspective, but then again, it all depends on the kind of financing.
2.09, what is the ROI?
I don't remember offhand, but should be about 10%. So the LCOE value was calculated at around 8% input cost, as in the debt, 80-20, and a 25-year loan. So trackers, at the end of the day, what you could generate on trackers, let us say if you're looking at a megawatt hour to megawatt hour, when you look at megawatt hour to megawatt hour, a tracker works out to be far superior both in quality. Again, this varies from tracker to tracker. There are trackers which have O&M issues. There are trackers that need to be greased, oiled, a lot of things that need to be done. Trackers that have a lot of components that are not really developed for a long life. So there's a difference between tracker to tracker. So it's like the same between quality of a car, varying on what you're looking to do with it. Now, again, from that perspective, because we're able to bring down the cost tremendously, in fact, you save on the 750 megawatt, we were able to save 750 megawatt AC, we were able to save almost 1.5 crore, sorry, 150 crores across 25 years just on O&M, right? The only O&M that we have is that it's a self-sustaining tracker, so it has its own battery. So you can actually, it consumes about 700 units through the entire year. And you can actually just change the battery every 5 years because there's no deep discharge. So that's the only O&M that we have in our technology. That is one thing. And so as you keep coming down close to the equator, the gains just go higher and higher. If you're talking in Karnataka, you're talking about a 20% gain for a 10% capex increase. So your LCOE, so when you use trackers compared to your normal systems, that's something that people are not very comfortable with. But LCOE is something that we're trying to bring in, where your cost per paise, let us say you've invested in an X size plant, your cost might be 4 rupees. With a tracker, that same cost could be 3.6 to 3.7 rupees levelized across the entire. So you're actually making 10 to 12% more than what you would with fixed tilt. So there is, if you look at it, so simple answer is on a MU to MU basis, million unit to million unit basis, trackers work out to be cheaper than the existing technology.
Thanks, Ritesh. On the O&M side, you say it's almost like a zero maintenance as far as your own trackers are concerned. But all of us know it's the life what we have seen of the trackers as in history is not very long. So what kind of test and what kind of things have been really done to build that confidence that for next 25 years, I am not going to have, or at least I'm going to have a least cost as far as O&M is concerned.
Perfect. So electronics are something you know life is. So at the end of the day, we supply the components. Electronics, you know, will last, again, based on the quality of the electronics that you make. Like you're talking about motors. Motors have been tested for now, how many, almost a decade, more than a decade. So you have testing results there. Our bushings, we use bushings. Those are self-cleaning, self-lubricating. To give you a background, we are from the automobile and the digital image and the mechanical industry. So the founders are actually the technology developers, and they have worked in the actual mechanical space for the last 20 years. And this is their third or fourth venture. So previous ventures, they have developed them and then sold them off. So they've been serial entrepreneurs. So this, we have our own salt spray testing chambers. In our salt spray testing chambers, our bushings are tested for 60,000 cycles. You're talking about one cycle a day that happens. So if you're talking a 360 degree, the entire plant does not go through 360 in a day. You go to about 200, so you have plus minus 60, coming back to store, maybe a couple of, so you would use about 200, 250 degrees. So one cycle a day. And we've tested it for 60,000 cycles, which is equivalent to 150 years. And after, so in our salt spray testing, we have introduced sand, we have introduced a lot of corrosion material, but based on the fact that it's a simple polymer, it's able to self-clean, self-lubricate. You don't need to have mechanical bearings. You don't need to have an IP67 casing. There is a lot of thought process and a lot of experience that has gone into this. Whereas what you would see in solar is that you would see the designing that happens, sadly, because it's a young industry and there is not much safety. Most of the designers are barely a couple of years out of grad school or 2 or 3 years. So there is a lot of understanding yet to come. In the wind industry, if you're talking in the thermal industry, you have to have seasoned people, people who have actually worked on those designs, who've made the mistakes. But in solar, I'll give an example. A badly designed plant and a good designed plant might have a few percentage points off until you actually wait in time when you see the cracks happening, in time when the deterioration. So if you overload a solar plant, sorry, I'm digressing a bit, but since it's technology, let's say you do an overloading for a plant, you do an overloading of 1.5 DC for a fixed tilt. You will never know whether it's performing efficiently because it is always clipping. So the efficiency, you'll never be able to figure that out. Whereas if you use with a tracker, that 1.5, you can generate with 1.3, 1.35, and you can optimize it further. Again, with the technology, what is the assumptions that are being taken when you're designing a fixed tilt plant? So again, those are all things that the maturity of the industry is yet to come. There's a lot of value that is yet to be understood. And a lot of people have yet to come to a certain level where we say, yes, we know what we're talking about. We still have a long way to go there.
Thanks, Ritesh. I think so, very, very informative thing from you, Ritesh.